Dear friends and colleagues, we are moving forward with our summer seminar series, and today we will explore how gender and body were represented in Ukrainian women's literature and visual arts under Perestroika in late Soviet Ukraine, a rather neglected subject of research. I'm very happy to introduce our today's speaker, Sandra Joy Russell, PhD candidate in comparative literature at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Just like our previous speaker, Trevor Erlacher, Sandra is a graduate of our summer school, where she was a recipient of the Sinkovsky Prize for the Achievement in Ukrainian Studies. In fact, it's hard to find a single North American scholar of Eastern Europe who did not attend our school. Our secret plan is to infiltrate every university and college on this continent. Sandra completed her MA in English Literature at Central Michigan University with a thesis on Russian symbolist author Andrei Bely. From 2012 to 2014, Sandra served as a Peace Corps volunteer in Lutsk, Ukraine. And after that, Andrei Bely gave way to Oksana Zabuzhko. Sandra's research includes Soviet and post-Soviet Ukraine and its diasporas, film studies, translation studies, and feminist theory. She's also a seasoned translator of Ukrainian literature, including the writings of Anatoly Nestorovy and Irina Karpa. Sandra's forthcoming article, to be published in the special issue of Feminist Encounters, deals with the last Soviet Ukrainian poetry by Iryna Zhylenko, Natalka Bilotsetkivets, and Oksana Zabuzhko. Sandra is also a project editor at Ukrainika, Ukraine's primary database, a project recently launched by Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute and managed by Dr. Oleg Katsuba. So please join me in welcoming Sandra Russell.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sergei, for that kind introduction. Thank you to Megan and Christina for your amazing work putting this together. You've made the process so smooth. And thank you to the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute and the Summer Institute for having this series. It's great to be back. You can't get rid of us. and I'm happy to talk with you today about some of my work. So I'm going to share my screen. And so the title of my talk today is Gender Embodiment and Soviet Apocalypse in Ukrainian Women's Literature and Visual Culture under Perestroika. I think I put this title together in January and things were feeling somewhat apocalyptic then. I think they're feeling even more apocalyptic now. So maybe part of me knew that this was going to be topical in some ways. At least that's the hope. But I want to give you a little background about this project and about my dissertation more broadly. My dissertation explores the literary and cinematic contributions of women in Ukraine during this period of Perestroika, around 1985 to 1991. And the big dream of the project is really to think about Ukraine as part of a transnational feminist discourse and how feminist discourses have developed in Ukraine. So kind of tracing a feminist genealogy. And a lot of emphasis, I think, in the scholarship has been placed on feminism's more recent development, particularly after 1991. And I think there are a number of reasons for this. And I think one of the big reasons is there is this belief, somehow implicit or explicit, that the movement of knowledge, movement of ideas, always moves from the West to this kind of hegemonic knowledge system to the so-called East, so-called West or so-called East. And then after the Soviet Union collapsed, boundaries became more fluid and porous, and knowledge moved a little more clearly, more quickly and clearly. And that's not totally untrue, but I think it's not the entire story. So I have a problem with this for a couple of reasons. I don't think it's totally accurate. I think it reproduces a colonialist feminist epistemology that's rooted in the belief that liberatory feminist thought is always moving in this direction from West to East. That women's liberation is some kind of gift that's bestowed by Western feminists in the 20th century. And secondly, I think it also assumes a kind of linear teleological progress narrative, the belief that things used to be bad and that now they're better, and inevitably they'll get better and better until we reach some kind of utopic ideal where there's no more sexism, no more racism, no more homophobia, everyone is equal. And I think sometimes, especially when I think about how history is taught in the US, I think that's often the narrative, especially with social movements. But I think this is an ahistorical model of progress. So the important thing to remember here is progress is never linear. Equality is not inevitable. We're not inevitably going to reach a moment where we're all equal. We have to do the work. So part of that involves talking about what's going on. And this still is from Kira Muratova's The Asthenic Syndrome, which I'll be talking about in the second part of my talk. Okay, so I'll be talking about four women today, three poets. The first, Iryna Zhylenko, in the top left. She's the oldest of the three poets. She died in 2013. She was part of the 60s generation. She was also a memoirist for that movement too. They recently published her Homo Ferens, which is a collection of diaries and memoirs and poems of the 60s movement. It hasn't been translated into English, but it's pretty big. The second is Natalka Bilotsetkivets, the second oldest. She emerged in the 1970s. The third is Oksana Zabuzhko, who emerged in the 1980s and is probably the most well-known of the three I'm talking about today. She's certainly the most widely translated, I think, and one of the most notable feminists, I think, in Ukraine. And then the second part of my talk will be about the filmmaker Kira Muratova, who's in the bottom right corner, and her last Soviet film. So my talk will be in two parts. The first is what I see as the poetic development of a more subversive language during this period. And I've chosen, there are a number of woman poets I can talk about in this period, but I've chosen these three, and Muratova included, because I see them as representing the body in a particularly unique way. and so, and the second part will focus on Muratova's cinematic representation of the body through illness and its eroticization. And I think in her way of using this representation as critiquing the physical manifestations of the late Soviet period and Perestroika. So I want to start by just clarifying some concepts. So this is a little bit of gender studies 101, because I think that people come to these kinds of discussions with different understandings of what gender is. And I want to kind of clarify what I mean by gender, feminism, embodiment. So when I talk about gender, I'm borrowing from Susan Galland-Ill-Kligman's work on the politics of gender after socialism. And they say gender is the socially and culturally produced ideas about male-female difference, power and inequality that structure the reproduction of these differences in the institutionalized practice of society. What does that mean? I mean, I'm talking about it as a social category. And one way to think about this is how one is legible within a particular social context. And legibility isn't necessarily visual, always visual. It's also how it's represented on your state ID, M or F. So this is very much a social category, and I want to make a distinction from a biological category of sex. We're all born with particular kinds of bodies, and that's great. But gender really refers to the kind of social performance of these norms, we can call them. And a little note about the distinction between how we might talk about gender in late Soviet Ukraine and how we have spoken about it in the West. In the West, women have historically been economically reliant on men, on individual men. This has changed more recently, but we're still kind of grappling with the legacies of that, and it's still true in some cases. But state socialism positioned women as reliant on the state. It kind of triangulated this gender relationship, men, women, state. So legally, and this is important, especially for Ukraine, women and men were considered equal. Gender was considered equal, but Soviet gender roles, of course, were still prescriptive. Women were still bearing a double burden as well as being included in the wage labor force. But the goal was to really build communism via their distinctive responsibilities. Again, this kind of prescriptive idea about gender. And I'm not talking about men and women. I don't want my talk to reinforce the binary either. I want to make that really clear. But I'm using the categories that were particular to this moment. And I also don't want to reproduce the idea that men do this, women do that. I think that's also incorrect. We're talking about nuances of how these categories evolve and how they relate to systems of power and our ideas and imaginings about nation. And a quick note about feminism. I also, when I talk about feminism, I'm not just talking about women. I'm talking about a way of acknowledging the interconnectedness of embodied categories. So we can also include race and sexuality in here. We could even talk about class, ethnicity, and feminism really refers to the tools and practice that can mitigate domination and oppression. So I think of it as a capacious category, capacious definition. Okay, a couple more concepts. I hope this is clear. What I mean by bodies or embodiment, when we're talking about bodies in the context of literature and visual representation, I'm also talking about a site of knowledge. So in many ways, the body is the most immediate and insistent site of knowledge. It's this medium through which we come to know the world, but it's also how we're legible to the world. And this is why I believe categories like gender, race, and sexuality matter, right? Because they are this way of knowing and being in the world. And finally, apocalypse. Again, this word has often carries kind of a gloom and doom to it, but I'm hoping to bring a more optimistic tenor to this, and I don't think it's always an ending, although it does very much often mark endings and often cataclysmic moments, but it can also be an unveiling. So I think of Andrea Apo's Shapes of Apocalypse, where he marks the difference between an event marking an end of history and one that creates conditions for a new world, this kind of transfiguration. But I always think of Avery Gordon's comment in Ghostly Matters, where she says, we need to know where we live in order to imagine living elsewhere. So I think we can think of apocalypse maybe as, and the representations of apocalypse is a way of knowing where we live in order to imagine an elsewhere, whatever that might be. Okay. So I also want to clarify, set up my discussion by talking about why this moment is important. Not a lot of work has been done on these years, as Sergei said. Perestroika, meaning restructuring, and glasnost, the politics of glasnost, meaning openness. I think I've said where it's important to consider this socio-political moment as itself a kind of performance, and one that was in many ways enormously disappointing for a lot of people, and also deeply transformative. So Michael, in terms of the literary scholarship, Michael Maidan optimistically notes that this moment marked the beginning of the opening of a Pandora's box in the process of restoration and return of a truly free Ukrainian literary culture. Tamara Hundorova similarly observes how perestroika literature, quote, seemed to be an integral part of the nation and state building processes. Assuming their historic national mission, Ukrainian writers produced works that would satisfy not only aesthetic, but also political and sociological and cognitive needs. So it's as if there was this void that was created by the Soviet Union, and perestroika kind of, through the cooling process of the thaw, and also to perestroika especially, there was a sense in which writers felt like they could finally meet this void and write politically and meet these kind of sociological and cognitive needs. So it's kind of, in many ways, we can see it as a promising cultural renaissance. And I think it reflects the landscape from which many Soviet writers emerged, one that was under the grip of restrictive and deadly censorship. And we can't forget Vasil Stus, who was executed in 1985. So it was close, right? Still very much close, that anxiety about censorship and even punishment. And I would add to Hundorova and Maidan, a characterizing the openness, by also noting how it was accompanied by new ways of representing gendered and feminist concerns. So I'm proposing that this intellectual shift that emerged from Soviet women's representations of specifically national as well as ecological, ethical concerns were often tied to their sexual and reproductive bodies and their concerns about their sexual and reproductive bodies. And so what I'm interested in here is the extent to which perestroika and glasnost yielded for women a sharper and more vulnerable articulation of their gendered subjectivities. And I think this is unique for Ukrainian women because their embodied concerns were also tied to this national interest. So this is especially the case with the poets I'm talking about, not so much Muratova, but I'll talk about that later. And through this, I see more complex expressions of intimacy and belonging, as well as a kind of articulation of this idea of Ukrainianness. And I argue that this language is what becomes really important. It becomes essential to Ukrainian feminism as a post-Soviet period. And I also want to add that I don't see this as the beginning of feminism in Ukraine or feminist thought in Ukraine. We can note numerous previous thinkers, particularly in the early Soviet period and the late empire, like Ukrainka, Olga Kublyanska, Elena Vredenska, Katerina Hrushevska. Oksana Keith has argued that prior to the Soviet period, there were a number of women activists and scholars working in Ukraine and challenging gender norms and expectations, but the Soviet Union ruined it by making gender equal, which is kind of a paradox. But that the argument was that you're equal now, you don't have to worry about gender, you know. So and then repressing any kind of research on gender or women's history. So it's almost like there was something of a gap or a repression for a long time. And Perestroika brought this to the surface. So I'm focusing particularly, there's a lot of poetry I could talk about with these three poets. I'm gonna focus particularly on their Chernobyl writing, because I think they all three wrote about Chernobyl, and they all three use this image of the body in particular ways. But if we have time later, maybe I can talk about some of their other writing. And this image is from Verlana Tak and Wanda Fitz, so the performance called Explosions in 1991 in New York. I haven't seen the production. I don't know if there's a recording of it, but this is just a still from it. And it was based on the poetry of these 60 poets. Iryna Zhylenko, I will start with her. Again, she's the oldest of the three, part of the 60s generation. And I should also note that the only poet of these three, or all of the four, actually, including Muratova, who self-identified as feminist is Oksana Zabuzhko. I am calling some of their work feminist because I'm thinking about that as a category for thinking about liberatory language and thought, but she did not, to my knowledge, identify as a feminist, at least not in her, throughout her career. So I'm not going to read the whole thing. It's here. I've also only included the English for the ease of translation. If you read Ukrainian, I can send you the Ukrainian, or you can even Google it. But I'll just read parts of it, and then I'll talk about some of the things that I see here. Now back to the chores: rake out the ashes, start the fire, sweep away the cobwebs, and cook some potatoes for dinner. Dead or alive, I'm still the housekeeper. Dead or alive, I'm still the mother. I come out of a deep, dark depression to feed my little son and tell him a fairy tale about happiness. So by her tone here, by the speaker's tone, it's unclear as to whether or not she's critiquing her domestic roles as mother and homemaker. I don't think she is. I think this is very much a matter of fact. But what I see here is this awareness and persisting expectation for this gendered performance caretaking, even in this moment after Chernobyl. The embodied act of womanness, or what we designate as womanness, is manifested through this role as housekeeper and mother. And in so doing, she preserves a kind of status quo, one that is seemingly crucial for survival. And so she describes this anxiety through an interaction with her son. She says, wash your hands, my son. Mom, a kitten, how sweet. You're such a poor little dirty stray. The clock starts to beat up the doses of radiation. Wash your hands, wash your hands, wash your hands. So she's also bringing the temporal in here to this, again, this boundary of knowing and not knowing, this uncertainty about the future. And the speaker's fears are really located in the natural world, in the mundane objects of everyday life that have suddenly become dangerous. The cat her son touches, the sand he wants to play in, the fish and mushrooms fed to him. And as a response, in the last part, she takes on the radiation herself. She says, my heart beats out the doses of radiation on every grain of sand and every little weed. Again, using the body as a way to kind of articulate this anxiety and to excavate in some sense this relationship between, we can think about maternity maybe, we can think about even reproductive angles to this, but the uncertainty of the future as, again, as represented through the body. The next poem I'm going to talk about is Pripyat Still Life by Oksana Zabuzhko. This is published in 1990. Zabuzhko, if you haven't read her fieldwork in Ukrainian Sex, which was published in 1996, I highly recommend it. That really put her on the map in terms of positioning her as a feminist writer. She was the first to write about sexual violence, about rape, about menstruation, about sex. And people didn't like it at first, but then she said that women would come up to her and say, this is my story. So it had an enormous effect. But what I'm looking at here is her earlier poetry and where I kind of see this language emerging. So I'll read a little bit. It could be dawn, the light crumpled like sheets, the ashtray full, a shadow multiplies in four walls. The room is empty, no witnesses, but someone was here. So Zabuzhko doesn't distinctly represent any gendered aspect of Chernobyl. Her poem rather constructs and observes a space in which human absence becomes a subject. And it's through language that she really excavates this affected space of privia as a way of helping us to imagine the unimaginable. For Zabuzhko, the speaker's focus is on the space of a home, this lived-in domestic private world of the social. She's not directly addressing, in other words, the failures of the state, nor is she giving a face to villains or victims. As she says, there's no witnesses. But here the tragedy lies in citizens' dislocations from spaces of belonging, this movement of the known and familiar to the unknown and the unfamiliar. Moreover, she acknowledges the violation of this intimacy, which she conveys to the absence of her subject's body. Did a couple live here? And the armchair or suit recently filled by a body has collapsed into a bolt of fabric. The speaker is herself disembodied, and by illuminating this absence, she is an observer rather than a victim of the tragedy. Yet this absence for Zabuzhko, I think, signals something more insidious. The freshness of the disaster, the immediacy of the loss, and the inadequacy of the state's response, as the speaker invites the reader to come in and look around. So she uses this metaphor of the boundary, and she uses this throughout a lot of her writing. And I think this is not only for the unpredictability of a post-Chernobyl Ukraine, but maybe a kind of looming awareness of a Soviet liminality, a country that would abruptly end, and like the victims of Pripyat, would find themselves reckoning with its absence. So I think the work of poetry here really disrupts this absence by acknowledging this boundary, this in-betweenness. And in this way, she recreates the place that has been lost. And I think this reflects her burgeoning feminist consciousness. It's through this parsing of in-betweenness, especially with the boundary of the body, that she really builds a language for her feminism that we see, especially in the coming decade. And the last poem I'm going to look at is Natalka Bilotsetkivets' May from 1987. This is the longest of the three Chernobyl poems, and it's divided into five parts. She incorporates a lot of dense imagery and description. You can see the stanzas are kind of formulated in a unique way or a different way, not linear necessarily. And like Zhylenko, she uses the experience of a child following the disaster. So I'll read the first part. A soft sob at midnight, still asleep, you can't remember where in what corner of the suddenly empty room. Was it there where your bed stood when you were a child, where the shadow of tiny breasts first appeared over the ribs during childhood? So she thematically returns to the image of children in childhood. This is a device that Tamara Hundarova argues, quote, reflects the condition of a new cultural consciousness that has arisen from the wreckage of a post-Soviet Ukraine. But I see it earlier. This is happening right after Chernobyl. And the poets of Ukraine's last Soviet generation are in many ways preparing for this new world. And this is through their representation of uncertainty and vulnerability of children. So her speaker, again, evoking this vague memory of childhood. So for Bilotsetkivets, there is a clear before and after Chernobyl, and they're treated as two separate lives, the primitive, marked by childhood, and the modern, which is marked by the machinery of what she calls the new century. I'll read the last stanza. Others put out the flames and the reactor's burning heart. We dressed in lab coats and DOS meters in our hands, the military epaulets and soldiers' uniforms, young pregnant women and girls with children that will never be born, victims, rescuers in the burning heart of Europe. The emphasis on compromised reproduction and motherhood is visible here, as well as in Zhylenko's poems, demonstrates the way in which women's writing reflects not only the somatic burdens of the disaster, but the extent to which this endangers a national future. Again, this return to kind of the sense of a nation and maybe the future of the nation. All three poets center the certainty of post-Chernobyl future as itself a subject in their poems. And likewise, all three utilize the image of bodies, either their presence compromised by the radiation or their absence removed from a space of belonging as a result of the disaster. In this regard, I argue a perceptible shift emerges in Soviet Ukrainian women's writing during this period, one that allows them, that gives them this willingness to articulate an indignation for what they've been lost or denied, and ushering in a clearer, more subversive feminist language that continues in this coming decade. Okay, so I'm gonna transition here and talk about Kira Muratova, whose last film, The Aesthetic Syndrome, is a strange film. I don't know if you've seen it or not. I recommend watching it. It's very interesting. Some think it's unwatchable. I saw it was listed on the I think the worst first date movies ever. So maybe don't bring a first date to it, or do, I don't know, it's up to you. But she is a different figure than the poets, because she was Romanian born and Russian speaking, but she spent most of her filmmaking career in Odessa. I'm talking about her as a Ukrainian filmmaker, but she's also acclaimed by Russian cinema as well. I think she's both. I don't think that's a terribly, I don't know if that's a contentious opinion or not, but I think she holds these kind of multi-ethnic identities. And she was supportive after 1991, she was supportive of the emergence of independent Ukrainian cinema as well. And in 2014, she was supportive of Euromaidan until people were killed. And then that's, I think she said, no motherland is worth the death of people. So. So this film, this is her last Soviet film. It was the last film to be censored. It was the last Soviet film to be shelved in 1990. It was censored not because of its nudity so much, but because of the last scene where there's a slew of vulgar language. And it wasn't until it won a Silver Bear in the 40th Berlin International Film Festival that it was released in the Soviet Union in 1990. And when asked about the film, Muratova said, every time I'm asked about what this film is about, I reply quite honestly, it's about everything. And it really is about everything. So I'm going to talk about a couple pieces of it and just a brief overview of what the film is about. Excuse me. So it's divided into two parts, but also includes small vignettes throughout. The first follows Natasha, played by Olga Antonova, a doctor who's recently been widowed and who is clearly not managing her grief very well. She acts out aggressively, especially towards men. She's self-destructive, she's depressed, but, and spoiler alert, we come to find out that she's merely an actress in a film within the film that's still allegedly directed by Muratova. The curtain rises and the audience grumbles about what a terrible, depressing film it is, which is kind of funny. I think it is in some ways a critique of maybe what she sees as her Soviet audience. And so this is an image of Natasha in the left, in the top left. And the bottom right, part two, focuses on Nikolai, played by Sergei Pavlov, and he's suffering from narcolepsy. And the film is kind of punctuated by him falling asleep in various places. So I'll be talking more about the second part. You can see this image of him with his student. He's making him fall asleep. And I want to think about specifically the ways in which Muratova portrays the body in this film, specifically the ill body, this kind of chronically ill body, and the nude or eroticized body. And I should also note that Muratova, and I think this is particularly because she was not ethnically Ukrainian, was not interested in this idea of Ukrainianness, at least not at this time, unlike the poets. So this is less so about, I think, a Ukrainian identity and more about her critique of the late Soviet condition. And she also didn't see much of the difference between the West and the Soviet Union in terms of human cruelty. I think she thought both spaces are cruel, but she kind of highlights the Soviet Union's cruelty in that she thinks it's harder to be hungry and tired and overworked, and that makes people even more cruel in some sense. So that was. And she also did not identify as a feminist. I think she thought that was a kind of unnecessary Western idea. Sorry. Okay. So here's a couple images of Nikolai asleep. He's also often, it's often like a crucified Christ in some ways. Film scholars have framed the asthenic syndrome as Muratova's diagnosis of perestroika. There's often this medicalized language with the film. Her response to social illness of Soviet society perpetuated by a dawning realization of a failed utopia. Ellen E. Barry calls it, quote, the exposed emptiness of years of simulated existence. Muratova herself describes this syndrome that she's portraying. So in the olden days, it was called hypochondria or black melancholia. Each time Nikolai can't cope with circumstances, he falls asleep. In the end, he falls asleep for good. So with the implication that he, in the end, dies. Again, spoiler alert. In other words, the film's diagnosis of asthenia, or this asthenic syndrome, is not merely a physiological affliction, but a societal one, visibly present through the bodies of citizens, which themselves perform as metaphors for what she sees as Sovietism. Embodiment in the film, oh, excuse me, I lost my page. Embodiment in the film provides this canvas for traumatic inscription, and it's through what is seemingly a loss of control of in the subject's bodies, particularly through this experience of illness and grief, that Muratova's apocalyptic vision of the Soviet Union, late Soviet Union, is realized. So the first is the ill body, or this chronic, this the narcoleptic body, through Nikolai's narcolepsy. And I think what here emerges is question of survival. Again, she, as she notes, in order to cope, he sleeps. And his body, like a corpse, is often unmoving and interrupting these public spaces. It's almost always in public that he falls asleep, and he's kind of this interruption, but also ignored by people around him. So here's a specific scene, and it's a little dark, but if you can see in the left where he falls asleep in the metro, and this is quite a long scene, it's several minutes. And he falls asleep in the middle of the metro, and the people moving through mostly act as if he's not there. They step over him, they ignore him, they're clearly not concerned with him. But we also see them yawning as they're moving through, as they're going on the escalator, as they're in the subway, some of them are sleeping. So this syndrome from which Nikolai suffers is already present or maybe latent within the public, and many of whom remain oblivious to its effects or severity. And so as you can see, eventually a couple of women pull his body to the side, his sleeping body to the wall, and prop it up, and a medic comes over and a policeman, and they have a conversation. And the policeman asks, is he drunk? And the medic says, only sleeping. And this is also punctuated throughout the film. Is he drunk? Is he dead? Is he sick? And he's only sleeping. But both of them yawn. You can see in the two right images before they leave the scene. So for Muratova, it's seemingly this illness or this asthenia moves through the social web from body to body. And it's a reminder that to the viewer of whether or not these symptoms are debilitating, this illness is still present within the public. And we could also talk about her use of food. I'm not going to today, the use of food in the film. There's a lot of eating, this kind of consumption. It's as if the characters can't stop, they can't control their body. So I think there is very much a sense of a lack of control of their body. So the next part, I'm going to talk about the nude or eroticized body. I see this as a kind of critique of Soviet masculinity. And so you have this scene, a party scene. Nikolai is he's looking for his sister who, if you look at the top left image, she's to his left, our right. She's a bohemian artist. She's having this kind of, this party that Muratova describes as a theatricalized erotics or an erotic game. A lot of scholars have repeatedly called this her use of this anti-erotic. I'm not sure how I feel about that. I don't know if we can decide what is anti-erotic or not. I think that's maybe something more subjective. But I think there's a sense of using erotics to kind of challenge or counter imaginings about sexuality and embodiment. So he comes into this party, stumbles into this party. He kind of joins in, but of course, as he does, he immediately falls asleep. We could also connect this to a discussion of the carnivalesque. This feels very much like carnivalesque, as you see in Andruhovich's early work, or Easterk. It's breaking the laws of language, or maybe she's using images in some way to kind of help us to think about sexuality, about death, and using this carnivalesque image to do that. So following this, it's as if the viewer enters his dream. And just a little warning, there is some nudity, so you've been warned. We see a series of naked bodies, 5 men and 1 woman. The men are fully nude and appear not to be so much powerful and muscular or aggressive, but they're situated among the neglected detritus of the everyday. Household clutter, mirrors, empty boxes, garbage, a television. The woman, on the other hand, is not posed among objects. Instead, she's standing against a white and black background. So in this scene, I think Muratova is redirecting this male gaze, or this idea about the male gaze, as we, along with Nikolai, is seeing these naked bodies. So he sees, in other words, the male body's vulnerability and fallibility. And in so doing, as Graham Roberts suggests, she demythologizes it or deromanticizes it from its Soviet imaginary of masculinity. So we can connect this with earlier Soviet film, I think of Zhylenko's Arsenal, with the protagonist, the last scene where he rips his shirt open and screams, "Shores," Eisenstein's Ivan the Terrible, this kind of image of masculinity that is particular to a Soviet context. So while I do see this as a cultural critique and within the context of Perestroika, and I think it in some sense metaphorizes her this loss of power, maybe a political loss of power, but maybe that's a little too simple. I wonder if we could think about how she seeks to reorient power or reimagine it. And I think she's doing the important work of challenging her audience's assumptions, not only about gender, but what it means for the embodied our embodied performances to be in conversation with broader cultural and political imaginaries. And I don't think Muratova I don't think she's interested in men do this, women do that. I don't think that's what she's trying to do here. I think she does think about body and gender as complicated things. But I think she's interested in the imaginaries of this dominant masculine order that have in many ways affected and limited a Soviet mentality. And so she's upending them in a sense, and she's asking her audience to maybe imagine otherwise. Okay. To conclude, by looking at the poetry of Zhylenko, Bilotsetkivets, and Zabuzhko, as well as the filmmaking of Muratova, I hope to shed light on how Ukrainian women's cultural contributions during Perestroika harness the increased openness of Soviet society to produce a bolder, more visibly feminist language or rhetoric. In a sense, they really seize this apocalyptic moment by pulling back the veil to articulate more clearly the lived experience of Soviet women in Ukraine, and perhaps a sense of the work that needed to be done. And so, as a comparatist, I'd be remiss not to try to think about the broader implications of these kinds of questions. I don't think these questions are unique to Ukraine or late Soviet Ukraine. Some of them are, especially thinking about the question of Ukrainianness and nation. But we can ask ourselves, what do our bodies have to do with our imaginings about nation? I think they're always tied. They're always political, and they're always tied to state practices and national concerns. And subjects, we have to be visible to the state, or else we don't exist. Again, we could think about the M or the F on an ID. And how are we made visible, right? We're made visible through our embodied performances. So we can connect this with more contemporary things. We can think about Euromaidan, but even more presently, the pandemic, who's affected disproportionately, Black Lives Matter in the US and globally. So there's a lot of ways that I hope that these questions become bigger questions. I think I'm using Ukraine as kind of a case study in this moment, the case study for thinking about them, but I want us to think capaciously about how our imaginings about embodiment affect our lives, affect social movement, affect the lives of others. So thank you so much. I will close my, stop sharing.
Thank you, Sandra, for this exciting, excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Actually, this makes me want to watch Muratova's films again. and we will wish you the luck with finishing the dissertation and then turn it into a book. Hopefully, it's going to be a book. It should be a book.
So. That's the dream.
With cool pictures. I mean, that's definitely,
I'll,
absolutely.
I'll include all the nude images, too.
Yeah, sure. Perfect. And I encourage our audience to pose their own questions. Students via Zoom, please use a hand option, and by the audience via YouTube. So hopefully there are some questions, please.
Or questions about life. I don't.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Everything you want to know about life. First from Oksana Zabuzhko and then from Professor Hrabovich.
Okay. Hi. Thank you so much for your lecture. I was wondering, since Husi is such a very interesting and unique experience, so how did it shape your future research and your overall perspective?
Oh, thank you for asking that question. I meant to mention at the beginning because Husi, it was such a profoundly enriching and transformative experience. So I'm in a comparative literature department, and in comparative literature, we have a number of national literatures and cultures that we study, and people are all kind of doing different things. So I didn't have the kind of groundwork in Ukrainian history and Ukrainian literary studies that I felt like I really needed in order to move forward with the work that I wanted to do. So Husi really allowed me that space and that opportunity to kind of get that groundwork. And it's ongoing, right? There's so much to learn, and it's ongoing with me as well. But it really opened up that world. And the connections you make are fantastic too. And the lectures, of course, I learned a lot from the people who came and spoke with us. It's unfortunate that you don't have the experience of being in Cambridge, but it seems like the remote experience has its benefits too. So yeah, no, Husi, and again, you can't get rid of us. I'm here.
So, coming back. Thank you. Question from Professor Rabovich.
Thank you for an interesting talk. Just a comment more than a question, although this obviously can also be turned into a question. And that is that you mentioned Oksana Kis as somebody who has done work on this, but really this was anticipated already in the 90s by a focus on feminism and gender as academic topics that deserve concerted attention. And the person who was doing that in Kyiv was Solomia Pavlichko.
Yes.
And I think her sort of seminal role needs to be noted. And anticipating her was our American colleague, Marta Bohachevska, mm-hmm. who had written on the late 19th century and the whole the frame in which Ukrainian women combined a feminist or proto-feminist mm-hmm. Agenda with also a national agenda.
Yeah.
So, yeah. The revival of Ukrainian literature and culture at the end of the 19th and early 20th century was mm-hmm. largely also made by women. So that is an interesting sort of development.
Thank you so much, Professor Kulbovich, for mentioning that. And I'm remiss to not include Solomeya Pavlichko and Martha Bohachevsky-Shelmiak, who have both contributed an enormous amount of work, especially with critiquing that relationship between nationalism and feminism, which is still a kind of contested piece of discussion when thinking about feminism's development in Ukraine. And I think it does, as you've mentioned, it's connected to that piece as Bohachevsky Shomiak points out, Ukrainian women were often more, placed more emphasis on their Ukrainianness than on their status as women. So that almost always took priority. And through that, there's kind of been this nationalistic feminism that's evolved that needs critiquing, because I think a lot of maybe Western feminists thought would dismiss it immediately because nationalism doesn't have a place in feminism. And there's a real reason for that, because it's often tied to things like white supremacy and domination. But in the Ukrainian context is unique in that way, in that there's a real question about autonomy as Ukrainian and the Ukrainian nation. So it's a really tricky, fascinating conversation that is very much ongoing and has shaped, I think, the contemporary feminist discourses. There's a number of really great writing. There's a lot of great writing coming out about this now. So I encourage you all to check it out.
Thank you. We have a question from Dr. Emily Channel Justice. Emily, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandra, for your really interesting presentation. I want to ask a question that is maybe a little bit outside of the kind of academic realm that you focus on, but the stills from the film reminded me of the Vina protest by the protest group that was a precursor to Pussy Riot. Did a big orgy in the Natural History Museum, and some of the imaging really reminded me of that. So I was wondering if you had thought at all about the way embodiment is kind of an essential part of feminist protest in the post-Soviet world. Mm-hmm. And that's also thinking about Femen, who is, arguably, are they feminist, are they not feminist?
Right.
But I was wondering if you had thought about the connection between like activist movements and embodiment too?
Thank you so much for that question. It's a really good one. And I haven't thought extensively about it, although I think that work does need to be done. I also, as you brought to mind, there's an artist, a Ukrainian photographer, a man who has recently, and I'm blanking on his name, but he has recently done a series of photographs exclusively on men's bodies, on naked men's bodies. And again, I think it's similar to what I see Muratova doing, as just upending this expectation about how the ways in which bodies hold space and power. Again, and so yeah, I see that in Muratova, but I'm also seeing that Shemin may be a good example. But the problem, I don't know if I'm the right one to speak about this, but it risks almost essentializing sometimes bodies, or it kind of turns to this hypersexualization, right? It's just, it reinforces this idea that all women have are their bodies, which is already, I think, a belief, an anti-feminist belief. And of course, women have much more than their bodies. So, yeah, I think this is where like cultural studies and anthropology and ethnography need to come together and talk about. I mean, Sarah Phillips has done work on this, Jessica Fohovich has done work on this. It's really complicated. It's tricky because I think that is, again, thinking about the body as this site of inscription, this epistemological site of knowledge. It's what we can use, obviously, but it needs more nuance. So yeah, I do have a mixed feelings. I mean, maybe we can think about the use of the body in activist context, but it needs to be accompanied by other kinds of work. I don't know if that quite answers your question. Feel free to add anything. I know this is part of what you've worked on as well.
Well, no, I think you summarized a lot of what I think, and you put it really succinctly, which is that a group like Femin sort of ends up indicating that all women have our bodies, and that's just not the case. So I'll leave it with your words. Okay.
We have a question from our student, Courtney Bauer, please.
Yeah, hi. Hi. Thank you very much for the presentation. Very exciting, very interesting. And I'd love to have that on a Friday before a weekend, so I've got something to kind of like, of course. But two things, a point of clarification and then a question following from that. At the beginning, you're talking about the film, you mentioned the woman who's depressed and she's struggling. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell, I couldn't understand exactly if you were talking about Muratova.
No. The actress, there's an actress at the beginning who just lost her husband.
Right.
So the audience thinks that she is just part of the film, right? That she's mm-hmm. just a character in the film, and it's in sepia too. It's not in color, and she's grieving her husband's loss. She's acting out. She's being a bit more promiscuous, but then we find out that Muratova is doing kind of a meta film. It's a film within a film.
Right.
But then suddenly there's like a stage, and then the woman who was playing the grieving widow is on stage, and she's holding flowers, and she's saying thank you. Like, so yeah, does that clarify?
Yeah, well, so you interjected there, you said, and I couldn't tell if this was the character in the film or if this was the director, Muratova, her perspective on basically capitalism and then socialism at the time and how it was cruel. And what I was trying to understand, where is that coming from? And then I have a follow-up question from that.
Sure. So she doesn't say that with respect, she does say that with respect to aesthetic syndrome, but I think she was talking about her filmmaking more generally as an aside, not necessarily as part of the film, but her critique of, I think a lot of people assume like, oh, you're just talking about the cruelty of the Soviet Union here. And she says, no, I mean, yes, but also I see cruelty in the West. I think it's part of this human condition. I think maybe she's readable as a pessimist in some ways, but she's more complicated than that, obviously. But
does she expand on that cruelty in the West at all? I mean, is there any of her writings, or does she, I'd be super interested to hear, I mean, obviously you mentioned the hunger part is extremely difficult, but I'd like to hear what her perspective on the West was too. That's very fascinating.
I actually don't know, but if you feel free to reach out to me, I can send you some articles on her. And her work has not been widely discussed either. She's kind of, I mean, more and more, I've seen more and more discussion more recently, But I don't know. I can't speak more to that. But
okay.
And you had a follow-up question?
No, that was actually it. I'll reach out to you. Okay. Thank you very much.
Please do.
Thank you. We have a question from our audience member, John van der Voort. Thank you for your talk. I have a question about the film's significance with masculinity and femininity and its awareness to others around us and how they view us. That is the question.
Okay. Hi, John. That's a good question. Again, I don't see Muratova as I don't even know that she was interested in gender. I mean, I'm reading her as interested in gender because she's doing particular things with gendered bodies. But she dismissed the title feminism. She didn't want to be identified as even a woman filmmaker. She just wanted to be a filmmaker. I'm not entirely sure how to answer your question. I think it's a good one. I think there's a lot of room to think about the use of the feminine body, the use of them. She was known for her use of men's bodies, though, in her film, more so than women. So there is something going on there. But I also don't want to essentialize that. I don't think she was saying women's bodies do this, men's bodies do that. I don't think that's what she was saying either. So I don't know. That's a rich area that I think needs some more work, but I'll keep thinking about it. Thank you for your question.
Thank you. We have a question from Christina Sorochan, please. Christina.
I actually have a few questions. By the way, thank you for the talk. It was really interesting and very informative. How do you feel about the current state of feminism in Ukraine? Because right now I feel like there's more of a nationalist focus. Mm-hmm. So yeah, what do you think of the current state of feminism there?
Yeah, great question. Thank you. The first thing I would say is whenever we talk about feminism, I would say feminism, because I think there are so many different kinds of feminisms, not just in Ukraine, but globally. And I think in the case of Ukraine, there is a lot of tension, and a lot of other people have done more work on this, and so I can direct you to some really good sources on it. But I think you rightly point out that it is kind of tied up in this conversation about nationalism and the concerns about nationalism. And maybe a good point of thinking about this is the discussions around the March 8th celebrations that a lot of feminists in Ukraine have been challenging because they see it as part of a kind of Soviet system, Soviet thinking about gender. And this kind of this idealizing women into roles of helplessness, right? So the focus is so much on femininity and how beautiful and wonderful women are and giving them flowers, then you're really silencing them, right? So I think that is a critique that's been, I think, approached by feminists on the far left, as well as more conservative feminists or radical feminists. But there's kind of an agreement there, but I think where you see splits are when it comes to issues like transgender folks, which I see a huge splitting point. And it's here too, right? It's here, and you can think about the UK as well. So a lot of feminists have been torn over this issue because it goes back to a real concern from the second wave of feminism, so earlier in the 20th century, about countering domestic violence. And that's been a real concern in Ukraine as well, this issue of sexual and domestic violence. So the anxieties I think about transgender people come from this desire to preserve this idea about femininity that I think is really problematic. And that's my opinion, that's where I'm coming from with my particular kind of feminism. I think it's problematic. I think it's problematic to assume that femininity is a kind of an inevitable thing. I think it's capacious. I think it can be so many different kinds of things, I don't think it needs to be privileged to certain bodies. And it's also, this is something I wanted to mention. I don't think I clarified it quite enough. Gender is as a category. If we're thinking about it as a category, as a social category, divorced from this idea of biological sex. Again, a little gender studies 101. We have to think about it as something that is produced through social and political and cultural means, right? It meets the needs of society in a particular way. And you could talk about race in the same way, you could talk about sexuality in the same way. It is very much produced. We make it. we've naturalized it. We call it natural because it's been told to us as natural, right? It's been long associated with biological sex, but I want to make that distinction clear. So I think that's maybe a location from which we have to think about the development of our different kinds of feminist thought. Like, who's the gatekeeper of the way that we talk about masculinity, femininity, gender? And so I think, yeah, there's a number of things going. I don't know if that answers your question. Maybe just to sum up, there are numerous feminisms in Ukraine. I think a lot of them are still invested in this question of Ukrainianness and Ukraine's future. But with that comes a lot of kind of conservative thinking about preserving ideas about femininity. If you want to interject or add anything to that, please do.
That was great. That pretty much answered it. Thank you. I have a small follow-up question. How did you decide on your concentration for your dissertation? Like, how did you cultivate your interest in this field? Basically, how did you decide you wanted to do this, I guess, in short?
Yeah, thank you for asking. So he kind of talked about this a little bit in my biography. I started, in college, I was reading a lot of Russian literature and of course got interested in the region. I wrote a master's thesis on Andrei Vile and modernism. And then instead of going right to a PhD program, I joined a Peace Corps and ended up in Ukraine, which was kind of a lucky accident, I guess. And I thought I would learn Russian. Instead, I lived in Lutsk and I learned Ukrainian. And that really kind of compelled me to think about the literary production in Ukraine at the time, because I was there in 2012, so before Maidan, but a big part of the discussion at that time was really about language. It still is, I think, about language in Ukraine, and this idea, especially where I was in the western part of the country, this idea that needs to be preserved and spoken. And so that really compelled me to do some reading. And that's when, of course, I discovered Zabuzhko, but also Perestroika, and others. So I started kind of doing the excavation when I was there. But when I started my PhD, I had to leave Ukraine, actually, because of Euromaidan. So I had to leave rather abruptly. And then I started this PhD program the following year. And I think because of that experience, I wanted to write about Maidan. I wanted to write about Donbass. And I did want to write about gender. But I realized very quickly as I started to do that work that it's really hard, at least in the context of literary and cultural studies, to write about something that's really ongoing and unpredictable and volatile and changing every day. So I abandoned that idea, maybe in the future, maybe a future book for some of that. But I think that's probably better suited for anthropologists or political scientists, not a literary scholar. So I asked myself, kind of what my primary interests were. And I think as someone doing some work on feminism and gender, I've always been interested in the body as kind of a site, again, a site of knowledge, a way of knowing, thinking about how our bodies move through the world and what affects them and how they affect the world, right? This kind of relationship. And when I read fieldwork in Ukrainian sex, I feel like that really kind of helped me to think about it in the Ukrainian context, where Zabuzhko calls women the sexual victims of the national idea. So thinking about how our bodies are always in conversation with the nation or imaginings about the nation. And we could place, we have to place race and sexuality in that as well. So again, these categories that we produce that exist within certain kinds of power systems. So I started to look at the late 1980s, the Perestroika, because I was interested in this question of before and after. So what happens when in a failing state, and also what's happening in the imagining of maybe a new nation or an independent nation. So this boundary space, I see Perestroika as very much a boundary in between those spaces. As a comparative too, I think this is an important piece in thinking about transnational boundaries, issues of translation, and how ideas move through the world. And again, Ukraine isn't necessarily unique. It's unique in some ways, but these are questions that we're asking globally too, right? So That's when I arrived here, and I found my advisor's a film scholar. She told me to watch Muratova, and I did, and I really loved her work. I think it's really phenomenal, although it's not everybody's cup of tea, but I think it's great. And finding out that she was the only woman filmmaker in Ukraine at this time, she kind of led the way into looking at poetry. And the next two chapters, I'm going to write about prose, and then I'm going to focus on the diaspora in the final chapter. So anyways, that's a very long explanation of my project, but thank you for asking. Yeah, it's a long journey.
Thank you for your answer. We have a question from another YouTube audience, John Sabetka. Please, have activists in post-cultural sphere drawn on some of the feminist literature in the Perestroika period to address modern gender issues? So again, the connections between post-Maidan culture and Perestroika culture.
So is the question, have activists in Maidan use Perestroika writing? Is that the question? Okay.
Particularly, yes, to address modern gender issues.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I see it more of it as part of a longer trajectory. I don't know that I would say that they're drawing from it necessarily, but I think Zabuzhko is a really important case here, because, as I mentioned, this is where I think her feminism begins. I mean, I think she identified as feminist earlier, but her writing really starts to take on this quality of subversion. And the poem I showed isn't as subversive as her other ones. There's another poem called The Definition of Poetry, where she writes about the body. And she starts to use erotic language in describing her body and connecting it to poetry or her ideas about poetry and her own relationship to it. And so I really do see there that move towards thinking about nation as part of this a broader kind of gendered and sexual imaginary. And so I think she's a good example. I don't, in the activist sphere, I'm not, I think there is a kind of, you can connect some of the, I've looked at some of the poetics of Iryna Maidan. There was a publication of a collection of women's poetry called Maternal Prayer. So already this kind of religious language that was often connected to the Maidan protests. But a lot of the poets in it, who weren't necessarily notable poets, they're just women writing about their experiences in protests, they use a lot of this mother-child language. So that's something that I think is ongoing too. I don't know that I would consider that feminist per se. I think it does deal with gender, of course, and it is very much invested in women's vulnerabilities, specifically women's vulnerabilities and children's vulnerabilities. So I think that has continued, that trope of maternity. And there's a long history there, I think, in Ukrainian literature, called the cult of the mother and child, this idealized image of the Berehinya, which is the goddess, the hearth mother, who she played, I think she was kind of resurrected, that image was resurrected during Maidan, because she's seen as this powerful, like, goddess figure, but feminists have critiqued her, that image, because again, it kind of essentializes women as only maternal or only domestic, right? And not necessarily agents, their own agents. They're still kind of relegated to the home and doing that kind of that work. So it's kind of tricky, because on the one hand, this image really did help women to like find a source of power within this question of Ukrainianness, but also it reinforces this imaginary that women should be mothers, women need to be at home. But I think that trope of mother and child has continued in some ways. But thank you for the question.
We have more questions from our YouTube audience, very active today, from Agbota Sodabaeva. Thank you for your presentation. What have you seen about the involvement or interaction of third wave feminism movements in places such as the US with post-Soviet spaces such as Ukraine that have different conceptions of gender and its relationship to the state?
Yeah, thank you. That's such a great question. Again, I think there is, So, as I mentioned, the definition of gender I'm working with is very much a denaturalized definition, one that's very much a product of the social. And I know a lot of feminists in the Ukrainian context are maybe don't see it that way, or again, I think I mentioned are more protective of this idea of womanness, of femininity. Again, coming from a very real place, right, to combat with sexual violence and gendered violence. But I think there is disagreement on what, and especially on the transgendered issue. And I think but there's conservative feminists here. I don't know if conservative feminist is the right word, but we'll say feminists in the US as well, who are anti or opposed to trans folks. Because I think they see it as a violation of femininity. And again, as I said, I have a problem with that because it doesn't consider the understanding of gender as something that's not exclusive to the kind of body that you have. I think that's the kind of more complicated definition that I'm trying to work with. But I think that's the distinction I would make. So the conversations are similar in some sense. But I think, I don't want to position the U.S. as being a kind of hegemonic center of feminist knowledge either. I think there's a lot of problems here. One of the things that we've been dealing with and that we still are dealing with is this question of intersectional feminism or queer feminism that has to consider the experience of Black women, of women of color, and that has been erased in the context of the U.S. So those discussions about race, I think, as I mentioned, have to be part of this broader feminist conversation, because we're still dealing with the race as a kind of a product of a kind of social construction, right? It's a similar conversation to gender. So we're all born with certain kinds of bodies, right? Those are often biologized, but race is the ways in which those imaginings have been produced as under certain kinds of power structures and positioned in opposition or in a kind of hierarchy. So, and there are many folks who can speak to this better than I can, but the long and short of it is, I think that, again, in this capacious definition of feminism, we have to consider the interconnectedness of these categories. And I haven't quite gotten there yet with my work, especially because I think there is so much work to be done on race in the post-Soviet context in Eastern Europe. But it needs to be, I think that needs to be considered. And I hope that answers your question. If not, please feel free to reach out to me.
We have more questions from the YouTube audience. Manuela Borzone, thank you for your wonderful talk. I was wondering whether you translated the poems and what the experience was like. And you translated the poems, yes. That's what's your experience?
Hi, Manu. Thank you for that question. The poems I showed here, I did not translate. I have translated some, and I hope to translate more. I had a fantastic experience translating them, and I also rely a lot on my Ukrainian friends to kind of help me with the nuances of language. I'm very much not a native speaker of Ukrainian, but my favorite thing about translating women's writing or feminist writing is the kind of collaborative aspect of it, that it can be collaborative, and that it opens up opportunities for activist spaces in translation. So I've very much enjoyed that. I've enjoyed connecting with other translators and feminists to kind of think about how we can represent some of these ideas in English to an English-speaking audience, especially considering that a lot of people reading in English may not be aware of Ukrainian, the nuances of Ukrainian poetry. So that does add a kind of complexity to what decisions you make and word choice and what kinds of maybe footnotes you might include. But it's something also that I think needs much more work. Iryna Zhylenko, for example, has not been widely translated at all. I think I can only find a few poems. And so that is work that very much needs to be done. Bilotsetkivets as well. There was a new collection just released of some of Oksana Zabuzhko's poetry and writing. If you have a chance to look at it, it's great. But there's a real problem, I think, a real absence of translation in a lot of these cases. And I think when I think about how the significance of these texts and writings in terms of in positioning them within a transnational feminist context, they need to be translated, or else we can't have these conversations. So that's work that needs to be done. I hope to be part of it in some capacity. So those of you who know Ukrainian and speak or can translate or read Ukrainian, I encourage you to try your hand at translation. It can be really fun. It can be really tedious. It can be fun too. So yeah, there's a lot of work to be done.
That was serious fun. thank you. We have a question from Thomas Fee. Thank you so much for such a wonderful presentation. One question. I'm getting the sense that the artists you've mentioned are expanding what it means to be either man or woman. But do you think any of these artists are leaving space for imagining what genderqueerness might look like in relation to Ukrainian identity?
Oh, that's such a good question. Thank you for asking it. I think if any of the four, maybe Muratova would be the most the most doing that. I think because of her use of, especially of masculinity, her critique of it. I think there's so much to talk about here, and I think it's been under excavated, under discussed in terms of LGBTQ writing. But I think if you think about a definition of queering or queerness, we can think about how it does take gender and sexuality and challenge the kinds of norms that have and assumptions around them. And it challenges, again, challenging the idea that these categories are naturalized, that they're inevitable. And I think that's very much aligned with a conversation about a queer studies conversation. So again, I think this is work I really want to do. I haven't found much of it in this period of Perestroika, I think still because there was still a little bit of reticence in terms of how open people were being about things like gender and sexuality. We can find much more of it in the post-Soviet and especially the recent past. As with translating women, translating LGBTQ folks in Ukraine is a really necessary and important thing. I don't know how much, I think there's still a lot of anxiety around this issue, a lot of, not a lot of people publish, queer people publishing necessarily. I hope that changes. I know that pride demonstrations in recent years have been, has increased and gotten better and safer. So I hope that there's a future in this. These are very much, I think we could think about Muratova as queering kind of her representations of gender, but there's more work to be done.
Well, we have still time for more questions, so don't be shy. It's been a very interesting discussion, but we still have time for some few questions. Anything you wanted to know about Muratova, gender?
Or anything you've learned from your experience at FUSI?
later. Christina, again, please.
You mentioned religion a while ago. I think I wanted to know whether you think that the Soviet state more rejected religion, and if that had any effect on kind of like the less censorship of Perestroika and how that affected than the filmmaking that we've talked about.
That's an interesting question. And I don't know a lot about the religious context or religious history here. I do know that in the Western part of the country, I think there's a larger Catholic population, which I think you can figure, I think Lviv is an important site for this. There's been a lot of movements to kind of preserve the family, which I think relates to kind of religious notions about gender, about where women belong, where men belong. And those movements still exist. I've seen a couple groups pop up about family. And it's always kind of coded language, right? Because you think family, that's a nice thing, right? they're really doing is anti-LGBT or anti-feminist, anti-queer kind of movements. So something to be aware of. I think that in terms of the, I'm not sure about the influence of religion in the text that I'm talking about today or the film. I don't think that any of them were particularly religious to my knowledge or used religion in their writing, although I could be wrong. But it's a good question. I think there's a lot to talk about there in terms of thinking about how what religion and what religious ideas can do in terms of shaping a kind of public thinking about these questions, right? Because I think what happens with religion, not all religion, I don't want to generalize, but some forms of religion take very, very specific, very concrete, unmovable, certain stances on particular questions, and they moralize it. So in moralizing it, it becomes unquestionable, right? If God says that, if God says something needs to be the case, if God says that men should do this and women should do that, then no one can question it, right? Or you question God. So I think that can become a problem. I can't speak to specific regions or questions particularities of this, but I do know that has been the case in some contexts in Ukraine. It's definitely been the case in the U.S. I think in terms of anti-LGBT movement, anti-feminist, conservative ideas and has long been tied with religious thinking. I think Trump's evangelical supporters is a great example of that. So there could be a kind of comparative angle to that as well. But thank you for the question. It's a really good one, important one.
If I may, I have my own question. You use the metaphor Soviet apocalypse, and it's mm-hmm. fantastic. And it's, as I understand, it's mostly applied to Muratova. So mm-hmm. what would be analogous metaphor or term with respect to poetry and literature, those female writers and poets that you focused on? Yeah. I mean, anything with Soviet collapse, apocalypse, or I'm not sure, they were not really upbeat and optimistic about the Soviet project.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think if we, defining apocalypse is not just this catastrophic thing, we can think of it as an unveiling, a way of knowing where you live, right? Knowing where you are. We can think about, maybe we could call the poetry apocalyptic in some ways, although it's a different definition of apocalypse, because it is peeling back those layers, right? It's peeling back, it's slowly kind of revealing the underneath. And I think in some ways that is apocalyptic. I'm trying to think of what a better metaphor could be. I don't know. I have to think about that. It's a great question. But it does that work, I think, that important work in those final years, right before Ukraine becomes independent, of orienting a kind of consciousness. I think that's the work that poetry can do. And I think I'm an optimist about poetry. Everyone has mixed feelings about it. I think it does have that power to orient the reader, to orient the writer, to kind of it speaks to lived experience, right? It speaks. It's not necessarily didactic. It doesn't necessarily teach us, but it allows us to kind of enter a space and imagine it, right? Maybe to, again, imagine otherwise. So I think it does hold that kind of power. And I think it can be political. I think it very much is often political. I meant to mention this, Bilotsetkivets, who wrote May, the longer of the Chernobyl poems. She said before Chernobyl, she was not interested in what she called political poetry. She was more interested in folklore, but it was that moment that she realized, I have to write about this, I have to say something. So she was compelled through that experience. So that's part of why I see it as so kind of transformative in that way, that moment, that maybe the apocalyptic moment of Chernobyl as kind of compelling these writers, these poets, to respond in some way. And all of them, again, addressing these issues that I think are particular to women's sexual reproductive ideas or identities. But again, I encourage you all to read a lot of some of the other Chernobyl writing. It's very interesting. Thank you.
Actually, we have a related question from someone under the account name Massachusetts Review. The question is, is there also a vibrant COVID literary scene in Ukraine today? And if so, was the post-Chernobyl period a sort of training for the current apocalypse? It's a great question.
Hi, Jim. thank you for the question. I think it's a fantastic question. I don't know. I think that there's something that's something to think about, right? And maybe not just in Ukraine, but global. I have seen some COVID poetry that's been really interesting, and I think probably will be ongoing, right? This moment has kind of been a world changer globally, right? Of course, it's been life changing. But yeah, I think there's something to talk about there. I wish I had a better answer to that wonderful question of thinking about, maybe we could return to the issue of language, right? When we're thinking about what kind of work does language or our thinkings about language through poetry, what do they allow us to reveal about whatever context in which we're living and how that context is shaping our world or unshaping it, right? Or compromising it. Thanks for the question. I'm gonna keep thinking about it.
we have time for one or two questions. Are there any volunteers from either side, YouTube or Zoom? Because we covered so many subjects, but well, I guess if not, thank you for your very stimulating talk. And again, it was fascinating topics because you connected, literature and poetry and film, which is the best. So thank you again. And we all wish you probably luck with your dissertation because it's really beautiful conceptual framework. It's ready. So, and please come back.
I will.
Tell us about COVID literary scene, finally.
That's my next book. Yeah. And
I also make an announcement that please join us next Friday for our next talk, also literary talk by Professor Hrabovich, entitled Recent Research and Publications on Taras Shevchenko and Pantelimon Kulish, the Critica, Shevchenko Centric Society, and Yuri Projects. So this is going to be back to the classic. So thank you. See you next time. The same play, the same time. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.